أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه وبعد. We continue with the مقدمة في صحيح مسلم بل الإمام مسلم ابن الحجاج القشيري رحمه الله تعالى. And we are going to talk about باب في أن الإسناد من الدين وأن الرواية لا تكون إلا عن الثقات وأن جرح الرواة بما هم فيه بما هو فيهم جائز بل واجب وأنه ليس من الغيبة المحرمة بل من الذب عن الشريعة المكرمة. So he's going to speak about, or this section is about أن الإسناد من الدين. يعني الإسناد narrating the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Originally and it is the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. By isnad, يعني who heard from who. Now, this is authenticating that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said. He did not live with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So, Sahaba heard, and they are saying to the Tabi'in what they heard from the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم. That's an isnad. How the Tabi'in hearsay, that I think that the Prophet said. Where you know, I heard it in the marketplace or I heard it somewhere. Well, it's not enough. But when you say that the Sahabi of Rasulullah told me, now it carries weight. And so on and so forth. So it continues like that. So it's not min ad-deen. Why it's not min ad-deen? Because it is to protect the deen. It's not is protecting the deen. You want to make sure that those who narrate, they are really qualified, that they really have integrity, that they really people who respect the statements of the Prophet ﷺ, that they want to carry it, because this is deen. So that's why it is part of the deen, to protect the deen. That's why Imam Muslim said that even the attacking, not attacking, or criticizing the people and showing their flaws as narrators, it is not backbiting. Prohibited backbiting. No, this is, in this case, it is permissible, even though he said, even though it is even more, it would be wajib. Because, you know, if you said, oh, I don't backbite anybody, but that person is lying, that person is fabricating something, or that person is weak. He forgets, and you take his narration because you don't want to say that he forgets. Or his hifz is not strong. I said, oh, I'm afraid that this is ghiba, backbiting. Then you take something from him, or the people take something from him, because there is no warning, and then you end up delivering something that is not accurate. What's going to happen? People will take it. People will practice according to it. People will make rulings according to it, and then they'll have a problem. Yeah. And then he narrates some hadith. First, قال حدثنا حسن بن الربيع حدثنا حماد بن زيد عن أيوب وهشام عن محمد وحدثنا فضيل عن هشام قال وحدثنا مخلد بن حسين عن هشام عن محمد بن سيرين قال إن هذا العلم دين فانظروا عمن تأخذون دينكم. So this author is a statement of Muhammad ibn Sirin. It is not the statement of any of the Sahaba, one of the Tabi'in. So one of the scholars of the hadith, Badruddin ibn Jama'a, rahimahullah, he said, "Isnad, raf'u al-hadith ila qa'ili." And isnad is to through a chain to reach to the person who uttered the statement, or to say that, you know, such and such person said it. and between you and him there is time, so you have to connect it. That's what isnad is. والمحدثون يستعملون السند والإسناد لنفس الشيء. And they use the word sanad and isnad for the same purpose, same thing, chain. ويعني sanad is to get to طريق, the طريق of matter. So we have a statement, such and such person said, Muhammad ibn Sirin in this case here, said, like, where is Muhammad ibn Sirin 200 years ago or 300 years ago? There is a matn now. Matn is a statement of Muhammad ibn Sirin. How I can reach to that? That is what's called sanad. well, the word sanad is the part of the mountain that it is higher than the other part. So the sanad is like going to that area. Also the word sanad means someone that you can depend on. He is my sanad. She is, my wife is my sanad. Or the wife said to the husband, you are my sanad. Yani means who you are, the person I lean on. So the word sanad also has that meaning. So the sanad is the person you depend on to give you the trustworthy statement. Or the sanad means the higher area. So means it carries to the highest area, yani, or the highest statement. طيب. Sanad has two components: the people who are carrying the statement, one from one, and the format that they deliver with. He told me, I heard him, you know, such and such person said, that is the tool or how it is delivered. But sanad first component is the people who are in the sanad. Number two, how they connect to each other. Means what do they say? Like how they carry from each other. It's not like two people silent and then you say, I have a sanad, you know. Someone has to say, tell someone something. Otherwise people live in the same time, but they did not learn anything from each other. So yeah. So that means like, you know, حدثنا أخبرنا أنبأنا سمعت عن فلان and like that. والصحابة at the time of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and after Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم in the beginning, يعني, they talk from each other and they don't have an issue because nobody like even thought that somebody would lie. يعني about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they don't have that. Like there is no such a thing. That's why in the narrations of the Sahaba, you do not say, is this Sahabi heard it from the Prophet or he heard it from another Sahabi? You don't ask that question. They will not say that the Prophet said without him saying, and they will not say something like they are doubting. Even the Sahaba will go travel for weeks and months sometimes to hear from another Sahabi to authenticate what they know. يعني this is how far they can go. At the time of the Sahaba, they were safe. يعني they were not feeling that somebody would lie on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But when the fitna increased, when people started dividing, when the people started debating and disputing and all of that, then we needed this isnad, who's saying. Who's here? Where did you hear it? Who? What is that person like? Look like? Like what is his qualification and so on? طيب. Now he is giving us the first author, and he is saying that three tariq, all of it from Al Hasan ibn Al Rabi'. Until he gets to Hisham ibn Hassan from Ibn Sirin. First tariq, he says, I heard, right? From Al-Hasan ibn al-Rabi'a, Imam Muslim, يعني. He heard, سمعت, right? Hassan ibn al-Rabi'a, Ibn Sulaiman, and he is from the people who took from تابع الأتباع. ويعني many of the authenticators of hadith, they authenticated him. Some said that he have some issues, but in general, he is strong. He said, حدثنا حماد بن زيد. حماد بن زيد ابن درهم الأزدي الجهضمي from Basra. And he is from the middle rank of تابعي التابعين. A great scholar, حماد بن زيد. وابن حبان, he said he was a blind man, but he memorized the hadith very well. وابن مهدي, عبد الرحمن بن مهدي, يعني from the scholars of hadith, he said he is among the four greatest محدثين. سيد مالك والأوزاعي والثوري وحماد. يعني سيد الإمام الأوزاعي الإمام مالك الإمام الثوري عند حماد بن زيد. فيعني هيز والإمام أحمد أيضا he said he's trustworthy. ابن معين he said يعني حماد بن زيد is someone up there. And Hamad now, he is narrating it from two people. Hisham ibn Hassan wa Ayyub al-Sukhtiyani. قال اسمه أيوب وهشام. هشام بن حسان السختياني. And those are the ones who lived with the junior tabi'in, the young tabi'in. وإمام also, great imam, حافظ يعني. اللي هو هشام بن حسان. وهشام الحسان was the kind of the most trustworthy student of Ibn Sirin. يعني whenever they want something from Ibn Sirin, they say Hisham. Even Ayyub al-Sukhtiyani is a student of Ibn Sirin, but they would take Hisham ibn Hassan. And they're narrating from Imam Muhammad ibn Sirin. طبعا he narrates another way, two ways يعني. Another two ways. Imam Muslim from Al-Hasan ibn al-Rabi' same Al-Hasan ibn al-Rabi' قال فضيل حدثنا فضيل another person now فضيل ابن عياض فضيل ابن عياض so they say فضيل or الفضيل يعني فضيل ابن عياض ابن مسعود التميمي الأربوعي و he was زاهد in Mecca و يعني he is from the middle rank of تابع التابعين great imam as well. Him and Abdullah ibn Mubarak has some discussions and among themselves which is better to worship or to do jihad. Or Abdullah ibn Mubarak used to go do jihad. Fudayl ibn Iyad used to worship Allah in Mecca and Medina. It's called the Abid al-Haramain. And they have some good nice literature between them. he was known for his piety and righteousness. Third way is also Al-Hasan ibn al-Rabi' he said from مخلد بن حسين الأزدي from البصرة well, he is from the young تابع التابعين as well تمام so that's a narration one narration second narration قال حدثنا أبو جعفر محمد بن الصباح حدثنا إسماعيل بن زكريا عن عاصم الأحول عن ابن سيرين same ابن سيرين قال لم يكونوا يسألون عن الإسناد فلما وقعت الفتنة قالوا سموا لنا رجالكم فينظر إلى أهل السنة فيؤخذ حديثهم وينظر إلى أهل البدع فلا يؤخذ حديثهم. So now Ibn Sirin is saying another. So Imam Muslim giving another statement of Ibn Sirin to explain the first statement. And that's the genius of Imam Muslim. يعني how he accommodates few things at the same time. His first narration is the strongest in the chain. And also he looks at the content. The second one will be maybe lesser in the chain, but it has more explanation in the, you know, and he accommodates few things at the same time. It's like somebody knows math very well. he said that Ibn Sirin said in this narration, said they did not ask about Isnad. He's referring to the Sahaba time. فلما وقعت الفتنة, when fitna of Uthman ibn Affan happened and Sayyidina Ali after and all of that, قال سموا لنا رجالكم. Then the people of Hadith start saying, tell us your men. Means, where did you get this narration from? Who is saying it? فَيُنظَرُ لَأَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ Then we see the people of Sunnah, we take their Hadith. The people of Bid'ah, we do not take their Hadith. Because most likely the people of Bid'ah is using a Hadith, regardless of its strength, to support their Bid'ah. But Ahlul Sunnah, they look at the Hadith and follow it. It's not like I have a preset mind. I have a preconceived notion. I have like already decided what I want to do. Then I'm looking for the hadith to do. Some people, they do that. That's not someone looking for truth. You are looking for the truth to support your hawa. But the real person looks where is the haqq, and they follow it. Even against themselves. يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُونُوا قَوَّامِينَ بِالْقِسْطِ شُهَدَاءَ لِلَّهِ وَلَوْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ You have to establish justice even against your own self and your own loved ones. So now, Imam Ibn Sirin is saying that how important it is to look who is the narrator and all of that. And he told us how it started. When he says, يعني محمد بن الصباح البزاز from Baghdad, يعني he said حدثنا إسماعيل بن زكريا. You can say زكريا and you can say زكريا, both correct. يعني pronunciation of that word and القراءات also. القراءات وهاب زكريا وزكريا كلما دخل عليها زكريا المحراب. يا زكريا إنا نبشرك زكريا إنا نبشرك زكريا إنا نبشرك زكريا إنا نبشرك It's different. فزكريا with the Hamza is a correct pronunciation of that. No. I don't want to go through all the narrations again. I just give enough يعني so far to see each and every one to tell you a taste, or to give you a taste of how the scholars used to do. So each one will say his biography, who is he, where he's from, you know, what Ibn Ma'in said about him, what Ahmad ibn Hanbal said. I was intentionally reading all these details. Why? To tell you how the hadith reached us. That's what they used to do, imagine, in every single hadith. Every single hadith. And not only that, like, you know, maybe there is a narrator here and he's narrating there, but his sheikh is different and the one who took the narration is different. So the ruling will be different. You have three, for example, between Imam Muslim and the Sahabi who is narrating the hadith of Rasulullah, there are four people. The one that Imam Muslim took from, he took from someone, and that someone from someone, that someone from someone from Sahabi. Example, yani there are five people. So maybe those are five aligned, give a very strong one. But not always there will be five aligned like this. So the one Imam Muslim took from, he took from others. But if he takes from this one person only, the hadith is accepted. But if he takes from someone else, we do not take it. Now imagine if you do that with each one with the other four. يعني this person from number two, from and number four changes, and the other one number three changes, and then number two changes. And all, can you imagine this thing? So that's why they say Imam Ahmad Ibn Muraz million hadith. Million hadith does not mean million different statements. يعني million different matan. It's not million different matan. It's this tariq. Is this tariq, and that tariq, you add to that that a letter may change, a word may change as well. So, and then the chain changes by itself. So you have a big task at your head. That's not at your hand. It is not something like really simple. It's not something that someone wants to, but because of their love to the Prophet ﷺ, their love to the statement of the Prophet ﷺ, and their eagerness and their care to make sure that it is authentic, that's where the science of hadith and ilm al-rijal ومتن وسند who said what said, you appreciate them. Only then you appreciate how one hadith will cost all of this effort. Now, So Ibn Sirin, he said, at the time of the Sahaba, they did not ask about who's narrating what. All Uduli, and all of them, they are very just. So they talk about, they narrate from the Prophet and from each other and so on. So most of the hadith of Abu Huraira, not necessarily Abu Huraira heard it straight from the Prophet ﷺ. He took it from other Sahaba, Ubay ibn Ka'b, Uzair ibn Thabit. But not every time he said, I heard it from Zayd that the Prophet did. I heard it from Ubay that, خلاص, يعني, Abu Huraira knows it, Abu Huraira knows it. يعني. And he said it in front of the Sahaba, and the Sahaba did not say anything. They learn from each other and there is no issue. But when the fitna, يعني here, they are not talking specifically about the fitna of Uthman and Ali, but they are talking about fitna in general. That when people start following their desire and all of that. And they started dividing. Then said, tell us who are your men. Now he comes to the third narration, Imam Muslim. قال حدثنا إسحاق بن إبراهيم الحنظلي أخبرنا عيسى وهو ابن يونس عيسى بن يونس حدثنا الأوزاعي عن سليمان بن موسى قال لقيت طاووسا فقلت حدثني فلان كيت وكيت كيت وكيت يعني such and such this is just a word that doesn't have a meaning يعني قال إن كان صاحبك مليا فخذ عنه طاووس بن كيسان is one of the تابعين يعني so he's saying that I heard from إسحاق بن إبراهيم ابن مخلد that إسحاق بن إبراهيم is ابن راهوية إسحاق بن راهوية والراهوية يعني both إسحاق بن راهوية من المروزي and he is the one who took from تابع التابعين وهي is the scholar of خراسان والإمام أحمد one time somebody asked him what do you think about إسحاق I said you asking me about إسحاق is this a person that you ask about فقال إسحاق عندنا إمام من أئمة المسلمين قال أخبرنا عيسى عيسى بن يونس بن أبي إسحاق السبيعي أبو إسحاق السبيعي is a great scholar of hadith that is his grandson يعني عيسى بن يونس بن أبي إسحاق السبيعي أبو عمرو الكوفي from تابع التابعين والإمام أحمد وأبو حاتم والنسائي وابن المديني they make him يعني said his ثقة قال حدثنا الأوزاعي الأوزاعي the great scholar from الشام أبو عمرو الأوزاعي his name is عبد الرحمن بن عمرو أبو عمرو عبد الرحمن بن عمرو الأوزاعي from دمشق الأوزاعي is like يعني the four imams But his fiqh was not documented like the four imams. الأوزاعي والثوري والليث بن سعد. All of those. He is the imam of the people of الشام in fiqh and hadith. الأوزاعي. فالأوزاعي narrating from سليمان ابن موسى القرشي. And he is from the junior تابعين. يعني he is one of the scholars of الشام as well. he narrated عن طاووس. طاووس is the imam and the faqih. طاووس بن كيسان. فهي is telling him يعني I learned this hadith from such and such. He told him if he is strong then take from him. في ثقة يعني وضابط متقن he's a strong person take from him the word ملي ملية ملي يعني يعني it's like a person he is يعني has lots of wealth when you say this person if he has lots of knowledge then take from him ويعني the next one number four is the same exact one about طاووس but he is narrating it from someone else حدثنا عبد الله بن عبد الرحمن الدارمي أخبرنا مروان يعني بن محمد الدمشقي حدثنا سعيد بن عبد العزيز عن سليمان بن موسى قال سيم يعني سليمان بن موسى قال قلت لطاووس إن فلانا حدثني بكذا وكذا قال إن كان صاحبك مليا فخذ عنه And the same statement but from different طريق. He's narrating it from عبد الله بن عبد الرحمن بن الفضل بن بهرام الدارمي، الإمام الدارمي يعني، حديث تميمي. He is the عالم of Samarkand from where the ex-Russian Soviet countries, that is where they call it Khurasan and behind the river and يعني Samarkand and all of that areas. سبحان الله، full of the scholars, full of scholars, the scholars who served the hadith really. But this is where Bukhari ومسلم والنسائي والترمذي all of them came from that area. يعني الترمذي from ترمز والبخاري from بخارى والنسائي from نسا، يعني that area. All of those they came from that area. سبحان الله. He's narrating it with his sanad to Tawus, the same thing. Number five. The fifth narration about the importance of Isnad, and that's from الدين. قال حدثنا نصر ابن علي الجهضمي حدثنا الأصمعي عن ابن أبي الزناد عن أبيه قال أدركت بالمدينة 100 كلهم مأمون ما يؤخذ عنهم الحديث يقال ليس من أهله. That's important one. So he is narrating this from نصر ابن علي ابن نصر الأزدي. When he took from the تابعي التابعين and he is ثقة according to the scholars of the hadith. قال حدثنا الأصمعي. الأصمعي is a great linguist. He has poetry and but he is محدث as well. عبد الملك ابن قريب ابن عبد الملك الباهلي الأصمعي. His kunya is أبو سعيد from Basra. He is from the young or junior تابع التابعين. إمام أحمد بن معين وابن المديني وأبو داود. They said he's strong. يعني. He's narrating it from عبد الرحمن بن أبي الزناد ابن ذكوان القرشي. And he is from the senior تابع التابعين. ويحيى بن معين. He said this is the strongest student of هشام بن عروة. هشام بن عروة بن الزبير بن العوام. Right. So يعني هشام بن عروة بن الزبير and it's from عائشة رضي الله عنها وأدر صحابة. He's the son of عروة بن الزبير بن العوام. Okay. His uncle is عبد الله بن الزبير. So the person who one of the great students of هشام بن عروة is عبد الرحمن بن أبي الزناد. يعني some said that he is not that strong. إمام أحمد said also some of his narrations مضطرب. مضطرب الحديث. وعبد علي بن المديني he said whatever he narrates in Medina is correct but whatever in Baghdad the people of Baghdad messed it up. See that have this specific, the artist said, if the narration coming from Baghdad, don't take it. If the narration comes from Medina, then it's okay. And he is taking it from Abdullah ibn Thakwan al-Qurashi. قولي بقى كلهم مأمون ما يؤخذ عنهم الحديث. See, they are عدل, good أخلاق, but they are not skilled. In the hadith. See, we said عدل ضابط. Remember, he has to be عدل. That's his manners and morals. ضابط means his science of hadith is strong. يعني he is well in what he does. فهي said those people are, I saw 100 people in Medina. كلهم مأمون. They are very good people. But you don't take hadith from them. So he's saying how important it is that. يعني do not take people like in face value, like, oh, he's a good man, he's pious and righteous. So that does not work like that. So he says here, he's saduq, he's salih, he's truthful, he's pious, but he's sayy al-hifz. يعني he's not, his memorization is not good. يعني he would narrate hadith that's not a hadith without even knowing. يعني he's is not intentionally narrating or fabricating hadith or adding hadith, but he is narrating those. Then number six, he narrates, قال حدثنا محمد بن أبي عمر أبي عمر المكي محمد بن أبي عمر المكي قال حدثنا سفيان وحدثني أبو بكر بن خلاد الباهلي واللفظ له قال سمعت سفيان بن عيينة عن مسعر قال سمعت سعد بن إبراهيم يقول لا يحدث عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إلا الثقات. Here is narrating the hadith of Muhammad ibn Abi Umar al-Makki and Abu Bakr ibn Khalad. Both of them took from Sufyan ibn Uyayn. So Muhammad ibn Abi Umar, يعني, one of the great scholars who took from Tabi' al-Tabi'in. Abu Hatim said he was a very pious person. So that's one tariq. The other tariq, that tariq is from Sufyan ibn Uyayn. Muhammad ibn Yahya عن سفيان بن عيينة. And then he said محمد بن خلاد بن كثير الباهلي أبو بكر البصري also same thing. He said also I heard سفيان بن عيينة. سفيان بن عيينة يعني well known. So سفيان is narrating it from مسعر ابن كدام ابن ظهير الهلال العامري أبو سلمة الكوفي. He is a senior تابع التابعين. فهذا مسعر قال سمعت سعد بن إبراهيم ابن عبد الرحمن بن عوف. So سعد بن إبراهيم ابن عبد الرحمن بن عوف فمن صغار التابعين يعني جونيور التابعين فيعني so this is ثقة all of that. So the يعني he's narrating these narrations saying that it is very important that nobody narrates except from Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم except الثقات. It does not matter he's a grandson of a Sahabi or he's this or he's that. Doesn't matter. His piety and righteousness and morals and manners and character is one thing, but his skill and strength in the science of hadith is another thing. So one is not enough. You have to have both. So a person memorizing all of this and that, yeah, you will take, but with a grain of salt, because this is the only one who have that. So you'll find some people with Shi'ism there, some people with Khawarij there, but they narrate a hadith because they are skilled. But we don't accept their bid'ah and stuff. But their morals and manners, they are good within themselves. Yeah. But there's an issue, which is the bid'ah that they do or preach. Now, if it is the other way around and that person is pious and righteous and everything, but he does not have the science, he does not have the rules, then we still don't take the hadith from. Seven, حدثني محمد بن عبد الله بن قهزاد أو قهزاذ من أهل مرو قال سمعت عبدان بن عثمان يقول سمعت عبد الله بن المبارك يقول الإسناد من الدين ولولا الإسناد لقال من شاء ما شاء. وقال محمد بن عبد الله حدثني العباس بن أبي رزمة قال سمعت عبد الله يقول بيننا وبين القوم القوائم يعني الإسناد. Another narration, two more narrations, one from يعني to both from عبد الله بن مبارك but different طريق الإمام مسلم يعني narrating the statement of عبد الله بن مبارك from two different طريق. One, he said سمعت محمد بن عبد الله ابن قهزاذ هذا from مروز يعني أبي جابر المروزي قال سمعت عبدان بن عثمان عبدان وعبد الله بن عثمان ابن جبلة الأزدي اوكي وقال سمعت عبد الله بن المبارك يعني هرد عبد الله بن المبارك وهو عبد الله بن المبارك بن واضح الحنظلي التميمي جريت امام طبعا يعني الامام يعني الامام سفيان الثوري He said, "What I wish in this world is that I have 1 year like Abdullah ibn Mubarak. يعني I live 1 year like becoming Abdullah ibn Mubarak for 1 year in my life." Sufyan طبعا ده he reached another level, but he is saying that about Abdullah ibn Mubarak. فهي said that I wish like that, but I cannot be even 1 or 2 or 3 days يعني. I can survive. سبحان الله. And he was a mujahid, طالب of the علم وحديث وعالم وفقيه ومحدث everything. سبحان الله. وعبد الله بن مبارك he's saying that you know, if it is not isnad, isnad is from religion, from deen. And if it's not isnad, everybody would say whatever they want, however they want it. Well, he said between us and all these people who fabricate is isnad, يعني القوام. نعم. حديث نمبر من narration number 9 in this section قال محمد وقال محمد يعني محمد بن عبد الله يعني the one who narrated from the previous two like number 7 and number 8 and number 9 Imam Muslim is narrating from the same person يعني قال محمد سمعت أبا إسحاق إبراهيم بن عيسى الطالقاني قال قلت لعبد الله بن مبارك يا أبا عبد الرحمن الحديث الذي جاء إن من البر بعد البر أن تصلي لأبويك مع صلاتك وتصوم لهما مع صومك قال فقال عبد الله يا أبا إسحاق عمن هذا الحديث عمن قال قلت له هذا من حديث شهاب بن خراش فقال ثقة عمن قال قلت عن الحجاج بن دينار قال ثقة عمن قال قلت قال رسول عمن قال قال قلت قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال يا أبا إسحاق إن بين الحجاج بن دينار وبين النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم مفاوز تنقطع فيها أعناق المطى ولكن ليس في الصدقة اختلاف. So now عبد الله بن مبارك is now it's an interactive discussion with one of his يعني students or someone asking him about the narration. So this Imam Muslim he's narrating that through Muhammad ibn Abdullah يعني he's saying that سمعت أبا إسحاق أبو إسحاق إبراهيم بن عيسى الطالقاني he said I told Abdullah ibn Mubarak I told Abdullah ibn Mubarak يا أبا عبد الرحمن he's asking him there is a hadith that the prophet said إن من البر بعد البر يعني بر الوالدين يعني when a person how to do بر الوالدين after their parents died so بر الوالدين when they are alive after they die في بر also yes so he's narrating this hadith that the prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said إن من البر بعد البر يعني it is بر after when your parents were alive that you pray with your parent for your parents with your prayer and you fast for them with your fasting So Imam Ibn Mubarak, instead of saying that's ضعيف, instead of saying that, he's telling him, okay, يا أبا إسحاق, عمن هذا? This hadith, you narrating it from who? You are saying hadith لا, about the Prophet, يعني. طب, between you and the Prophet, there are, Abdullah Mubarak telling him, from who? عمن هذا? قال, قلت هذا من حديث الشهاب بن خراش. يعني, this is the hadith that as you know Shahab ibn Kharash is saying it فهي told him هذا ثقة يعني this person is strong Shahab ibn Kharash ibn Hawshab is strong from the senior تابعي التابعين okay so he told him that's fine this is a strong person عمن يعني he's from who يعني narrating it from who قال عن الحجاج ابن دينار okay so he told him this hadith is from حديث شهاب بن خراش he told him good from who قال عن الحجاج ابن دينار he said he's ثقة also حجاج ابن دينار is ثقة strong then from who He told them Al-Hajjaj ibn Dinar said, Rasulullah said. He told them now, يعني, between Al-Hajjaj ibn Dinar and Rasulullah, there are lots of deserts that, you know, camels will die to cross. And he's telling him there are people between this. This is not right, even though he's siqa, but we don't accept that like this. يعني he is from the senior تابع التابعين. ابن مبارك said he's siqa, like this hadith here, وابو داود وابو خيثمة والإمام أحمد وابن معين said there is nothing wrong with him, وابو زرعة رازي. الإمام الدارقطني said he's not that strong, but still, يعني, he said, but this hadith is مرسل معضل, يعني مرسل ومعضل. مرسل is not like one person only missing. لا, there is more than one missing, and he is more than one. يعني he's telling him that between him and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم a lot, but there is no اختلاف in صدقة. You can give صدقة on behalf of your parents. That's okay. Some people lost the reception. So this narration number 9 that Imam Muslim ibn al-Hajjaj is narrating with his sanad to Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak, that when somebody asked him, there is a hadith about al-birr for my parents after the birr of the parents after they die. So I told him to pray for them with your prayer. يعني do salah for them. Do siyam with them for them, or do sadaqah for them. So he told him first that according to the science of hadith, this hadith is mursal mu'dal. يعني there is someone, more than one person missing from the end of the hadith. Even though this person is thiqa, but he's narrating straight from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, means who are your shaykh? طيب. That's about the science of hadith. Then he told him, but in regards to the subject, there is no ikhtilaf among the scholars in sadaqah. So he gave him a fiqh, يعني fatwa as well. They give him the fatwa as well. So he told him, يعني there is no ikhtilaf in sadaqah. طبعا there is you can make dua for them. There is no ikhtilaf on that. You can make sadaqah for them. There is no difference in that. You can do the good deeds that they used to do. ما في مشكلة. And you can do Umrah and Hajj for them also. There is no issue. But the issue is in fasting and the Salah. Do you pray for someone or not? في debate يعني among the scholars. Fasting, you can make up the fasting as well. في some اختلاف. But there are يعني narrations and statements that you can do fasting on the behalf of someone who did not fast. ممكن. Salah فيها يعني اختلاف. وقراءة القرآن فيها اختلاف also. يعني the recitation of Quran is sometimes you say those بدعة and not بدعة. لا, بس في يعني تابعين وفي من السلف people they recite Quran and give the reward for the person. في اختلاف يعني. Now reciting the Quran in a group also في اختلاف. يعني do not think that it is one clear cut like opinion. يعني when you study in the fiqh you will see, are they reciting together يعني with one voice Alhamdulillah like that, all of them? طبعا في issues. يعني if every level there is اختلاف in it. You recite Quran alone and give the reward for someone who died, that in itself has اختلاف. طيب, you're going to recite it in jama'ah. Are the jama'ah each one reading like one portion and then they giving or not? في اختلاف. Are the whole the jama'ah reading the same exact thing? Are they saying it in loud voice or not? في اختلاف. يعني all في مختلفين, you know, in all of that. And then when you you find statements like هذا بدعة وهذا حرام, you have to be careful, you know, like when somebody says that, it is the easiest thing to classify it as such. It's the easiest thing, يعني, to make people do or people don't. But it's very hard that when there are some اختلافات, because اختلاف opens opens a gate of tolerance, and this اختلاف is اختلاف اختلاف يعني مشروع, يعني it is permissible اختلاف or not, اختلاف يعني مقبول, it is اختلاف that we can accept or not. يعني it opens a bigger gate of scholarship. And people don't want to go to that. They want a clear cut. Just tell people don't do it and that's it. And that's why you find that a school, يعني, over the past 100 years was based on that. One way and that's it. And there was no difference, يعني, between, for example, the Hanafi madhab followers in the Indian subcontinent and the يعني the people who are in Jazeera or Arabia and those who follow them and said were Salafis and all that. So there was no big difference. يعني. Each one is adhering to one way and that's it. And there is no space for ikhtilafat. خلاص. We are going to use that and choose that way and that's the only way. That's fine for you, but don't label everybody else as bid'ah or everybody else as wrong. And that's where the mistake is. Like the Hanafi, those who adhered to the Hanafi, they became so timid and strong within themselves until they themselves divided to Deobandis and Bareilwis. And the Deobandis themselves divided, and the Bareilwis was divided among them. You keep dividing like that because you are alienating everybody else. If this is your main methodology, then you'll alienate yourself eventually. Eventually, at the end, you'll find yourself, you are by yourself. And the same thing happened on the other side. You know, they say this bid'ah, then they become the Salafi, then the super Salafi, then the ultra super Salafi. Where are we going with this? You decide exactly where you are. You take a good name and you do things with it that makes people run away from it. Both are good. يعني you are now relating to Imam al Kabir Abi Hanifa and Nu'man. Great, stick with that. Stick with that. But Imam Abi Hanifa did not make takfir to everybody else, he did not make tabdi' to everybody else, he did not, you know, say all the what Malik said is wrong, what he did not. Simply did not. يعني that was the tolerant time, you know, like none of them did that to the others. They coexisted, they differed from each other, but they were high up there, you know, to respect. And everybody can go to Malik and then go to the students of Abu Hanifa, take from Shafi'i. It was not like an issue that we are making it right now. Yeah, and I'm imagining at the time that Malik was there, was Shafi'i was there, or Shafi'i there and Ahmed there, and their personal relationship with each other. Really, يعني. Why I'm Hanbali or Shafi'i and we're differing that much? Like why? Like why when Imam Malik and Shafi'i or Shafi'i and Ahmed, they were actually close. Very close. So why the followers are different? Because the followers took it to another level. Same thing, you are relating to a Salaf al-Salih. When you say I'm Salaf, يعني, this is a big thing. This is just, it's like you are saying that, you know, I am trying to be following the best model there is. But then when you judge everybody also as wrong and all of this, it's not good. Look, Abdullah Mubarak is saying, who narrated this? Who narrated this? He's taking him step by step. يعني. So saying, less hadith and wakada. He's not doing all of that. But that's part, يعني, I wanted to mention.
Sheikh, can we have a small discussion about this topic يعني, after
Fadda. Class, inshallah? Fadda now.
Oh, okay, now. Okay, talk to me. But yani, recently, yani, there's been a more of a conservative push, and so there's been a notion that, you know, Islam today in modern day, I'm not talking about yani, as a religion. But in modern day, yani, our weakness within our ummah, like why we're so weak as the froth yani, on the oceans, is because there's too many people using the excuse that there are difference of opinions. And so they use that to hide hidden agendas that destroy and separate the ummah. So it would be interesting to discuss this topic and how we can have a roadmap of I mean, my take on it was to focus on the aqidah first. If everyone focuses on the aqidah, then everything will be lined up properly, inshallah. But they could be on a different roadmap or a discussion on how we can, I guess, create this model of tolerance in this modern day today, with authenticity, like an authentic tolerance, not a subjective based on the society type of tolerance.
Good. So, if I paraphrase what you mentioned, yeah, and the point is that you're saying this difference or tolerance, difference of opinions and all that, it is used as a pretext to, you know, get weakness into the ummah and all of that. Instead, you have to stick to something solid and strong. Yes?
Correct, yeah, something black and white.
Good,
instead of having
good.
Something different shapes.
I get it. I just wanted to emphasize. Anybody have a take on this before I say anything? Anybody has have a take on this?
I would say, in terms of being able to accept the differences, it gives us strength. Because our communities are never going to be monolithic. It's never going to be one size fit all for everything. And so to understand that even the Sahaba themselves differed in the presence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with certain fiqh rulings and things like that, we could say, okay, you know, people have different understandings. As long as they're not, like you said, don't take care of other people, then we should be willing to accept those differences. And I think that makes us stronger. But when everyone wants to say my way is the only way, I think that's when we are going to start to have differences and weaknesses inside the ummah.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh Tayyib. Barakallah feek. Anybody else? Okay. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Faddal. No. I want to hear everybody. Yes.
I was saying my personal take was that if the faith or the understanding of the faith is firm in the basis of it, you know, the what is ghaib is truly understood as, you know, the way it's supposed to be ghaib, instead of making up a definition of what can be ghaib and what can't be ghaib. You know, something that deals with the firmness of the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first, and the source, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself. We can discuss that one later on, but the main thing is the first thing is the aqidah and the faith. I mean, just to,
right,
and
right.
Of course, we.
I got it, Sheikh Hussain.
We're getting that from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but he drew the guidelines for us on what they're, you know, Jibreel alayhi salam is the one who drew us the guidelines for that, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained it. So that was my personal take,
yani,
Allah
Alam. Jazakallah khair, Allah barik. Now,
may I throw in my 2 cents?
No, it's not 2 cents, it's more expensive than that. Just go ahead.
I'm approaching it from a slightly different angle, like, I guess, from a historical perspective. Like, I know you mentioned the Indian subcontinent, what you said, I thought was pretty spot on. In terms of how they approach their, you know, the fiqh matters, and how, rather than encouraging the difference of opinion, they're very strict in terms of taking one position. And I think, from my personal perspective, it comes down to just a historical analysis, particularly of the Indian subcontinent, since they underwent colonization, there was a kind of like a struggle from a psychological standpoint. And you can say a spiritual standpoint, like a religious standpoint, of identity and purpose, you know? So, like, you would see from the Muslims at that time, or this is my guess, that you would see from the Muslims at that time that they were, like, trying very hard to hold on to their identity in opposition to the British, right, to the colonizers, right? So that to them was holding on to whatever aspect of Islam existed within that region. So it itself kind of removed the like the possibility of like difference of opinion, because any difference of opinion is seen as a attempt to, you can say, like, reform the religion, or like deviating from what they understood to be Quran and Sunnah.
Okay, Jazakallah khair. Anybody else? What you just did, all of you, is actually a proof of what I just said. يعني أسامة give a perspective, طيب give a perspective, and Hamad give a perspective, and all of those perspectives are correct. Yeah. So, and they existed since the beginning of time. يعني after the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, when the Prophet was there, nobody have any ijtihad. يعني nobody can say do this or do that. It's one way or another way. It's one way. It's the way of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and that way has multi ways in it. يعني he told certain Sahaba certain things. And now fast forward, you go to Imam Malik, and when one of the Khalifas tell him that we have to do al Muwatta, which is one way, I want people to follow that madhab, he told them don't do it. Why? Because you know the Sahaba went all over, and each one have a piece of knowledge that the other one doesn't have. And if you make it one way, then people will start accusing each other, you know, and saying you're right and you're wrong. So he is saying that there are lots of teachings that can be, you know, with tolerance. So Imam Malik himself, when he is strict within his own school, he is saying let everybody else exist as well. So that tells us. So now look at us, we are each saying their opinion. So now it's a proof that it is continued. Yani we are in one class, but each one is carrying an angle different from the other. At the end of the day, it you know gives like, okay, so someone who said it has to be black and white and all of that. Well, that's good. You know, try. But don't judge everybody else as if they don't want it black and white, they want more details, they don't want variety, they wanted to pick from something, that's fine. And so don't say that this is the only way and have to do it. يعني. Even a Khalifa wanted to do it, and Imam Malik told him don't. And Imam Malik had a chance to, as we think, يعني, solve all these problems, and they said, you know, my madhab is the madhab and that's it. But what guarantees that? The next Khalifa comes and he said, you know, I don't like this madhab. You know, let me put another madhab. Then what is going to happen? Same thing. The same end will, yeah, you know, the end result will be the same. After a while, people were pushed to the black and white lane. After a while, someone come and said, you know, guys, what? No, you have a bigger variety. Then people will go out of that and people will come into that. So there will always be push and pull. ولولا دفع الله الناس بعضهم ببعض لفسدت الأرض. There will always be push and pull, and that's the only way. But when the Prophet is alive among you receiving wahi, you don't have an option. The deen is not complete yet, but once the deen is complete, there is variety within it. That's why Abdullah ibn Mas'ud went to al-Kufa, and Abdullah ibn Abbas was in Mecca, Anas ibn Malik was in Basra, وعمر بن العاص and Abdullah ibn Amr was in Egypt. ويعني أبو الدرداء went to Damascus. Each one of those was a school in himself. And as a result came the four schools of fiqh. And you see the differences among them. You think يعني these people in a vacuum, like they receive wahi, يعني أبو حنيفة ومالك والشافعي وأحمد بن حنبل, they invented a new religion. And they didn't. They came up with their opinions from the tabi'een who took it from sahaba, from Rasulullah. يعني each one of them at the end is providing an understanding of Islam from Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. Otherwise, يعني people would have judged them that they're not Muslims. يعني. And the ulama already did not leave them like that. They said in that part, Abu Hanifa was different from al-Ijma. In that part, Malik was different. In that part, Shafi'i was different. In that part, Ahmed was different. They stated that. But did they say wrong? Don't follow it? No. تمام؟ يعني في عندنا في مسائل النكاح. All the جمهور is لا نكاح إلا بولي. صح؟ لا نكاح إلا بولي وشاهدي عدل. And they're very strong and adamant about it, which I take it, by the way. I believe in that. يعني. But there is the opinion of الأحلام. يعني when they say the wali is not a condition, they are not saying go ahead and get married without a wali. They don't do that. يعني Abu Hanifa marry his daughter يعني without a wali, tell his daughter go without a wali. This is not the point. The point here is the wali a rukn of aqd or not. It's merely a technical issue. يعني they are not inviting anyone to go do the nikah without a wali, like what people understand now. But if the nikah is done, is it correct or not? That's a technicality. Now, the issue of a girl marrying without her father's permission is more of a moral issue, not a halal and haram issue, according to the Hanafi. يعني. And when you discuss with them, you see their point. يعني said, why la here is tahrim, la for tahrim, يعني. Why it is not like it is better to have the, يعني la nikaha, يعني la nikah perfect, يعني. كامل يعني when they said لا إيمان لمن لا أمانة له يعني there is no إيمان for a person who does not have أمانة يعني if a person who does not have أمانة become a kafir now right what is that so لا here is not نافية للجنس يعني it is not negating completely the validity of something so والله لا يؤمن من لا يأمن جاره بوائقه من لا يأمن يعني the neighbor is not safe from his he is not a believer means he's not a complete believer means he's not a kafir now لا يزني الزاني حين يزني وهو مؤمن the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said the zani when he is making zina he's not a believer يعني he's a kafir بعد الزنا he has to accept Islam again or what all this hadith And then they come and say, طيب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم come and say, لا صلاة لجار المسجد إلا في المسجد. يعني there is no صلاة for the person who is the neighbor of the masjid except in the masjid. طب what if he prays at home? His صلاة is not valid يعني؟ خلاص يعيد الصلاة؟ Some of the Zahiri said yes. He has to pray at the masjid. طب what if the poor guy is sick يعني? What should he do? Like what if he is late or يعني؟ They said this لا نكاح إلا بولي is like that يعني. فيعني they have a point. I'm not saying their point is strong from a fiqhi, analytical, usuli perspective is weak. We're not going to get into that discussion. But I'm just trying to say that there's a point. طيب يعني if someone comes to me now in my office and said, Sheikh, my daughter did the nikah and she consummated the marriage and all of that and I was not present and all of this. So invalidate this marriage. According to the Jumhur, yes, I have to invalidate that marriage and say that marriage. بس في شبهة نكاح الآن. What they did now is zina يعني? What should I do? What if she gets pregnant now? You see the point? So there is some issue. في شبهة نكاح, we said, yeah, we just can redo the nikah, please, you know, accept it to make it work, otherwise it will become an issue. فيعني you validate something that you do not want to validate. So the يعني back to my point again. We can go to examples, but back to my point that what we did is the exercise that we just did now is a proof that there is tolerance. Okay, that's number one. Now when I go from more of an academic perspective, where's the problem? Like يعني when You know, what is exactly the problem and who's talking about it? Like you think that we talking about it, it solves it? What authority do you have when you say my personal opinion? What does it weigh in the ummah, yani? Personal opinion. When the ulama say their word, khalas. But if you find someone saying this is the only one, everybody else is wrong, that is wrong in itself. Like, what are they doing? Are they doing, يعني, like, following another religion? Or they are doing something within the religion? You have to ask yourself. Where is the issue? The issue is that we, as a Muslim ummah, suffering that we do not have a head. We do not have a leader. I'm talking about one leader, Khalifa, يعني. You don't have that. Then this issue will continue like this. Because nobody is abiding. Everybody is not abiding by the same. When you are abiding by the same, And then the Khalifa comes and say, you know, the madhab of the Indian subcontinent is not Hanafi anymore. You're going to follow that. He's a Khalifa, right? He will say that, you know, that's it. I'm not Mufti al-A'zam or al-Akbar lil-Ummah al-Islamiyya sayakoonu ala al-madhab al-Shafi'i. What are you going to do about that? Then it's going to be like what Osama suggested. It has to have a political clout. It has to have a political authority. You have to have like a power to do that. Otherwise, yours is merely a suggestion. It does not do anything. It's just, it was said before, and it's said now, and it's going to be said again. what authority do you have to implement what you think? And if you see, if you think what you have is right, my opinion, I think my opinion is right. Okay, how right it is, we don't know. Would there be a way to apply? No. Would there be any weight for it, يعني, on somebody? No. You cannot even implement that in your own family. That is kind of like the irony of it. يعني in your own family here in the United States, you go kid or tell your kids, you guys all have to pray the same way. Look what happens. Good luck. Good luck implementing that. يعني. You'll find your son telling you, isn't it okay to do such and such? Isn't it okay to make my finger like this? Isn't it haram يعني to make it like one that? No authority, what I'm saying. You do not have authority even in your own backyard, your family. But your suggestion is just a suggestion. يعني, and I'm not offending anybody here. I'm just trying to address it from an academic perspective. What is the issue? What is the issue? And the issue is the Muslim Ummah divided. Okay, how you bring that back? You can suggest. But looking at the history, what did work? Nothing worked. The Ummah stayed with the tolerance and variety. They were the best of the shapes. When they are like in the, you know, like tolerance and variety and all of that. The minute they become timid and black and white, not everybody is going to listen to you, even when you are the Khalifa. But which حاجة اسمها black and white? You cannot for you are not a prophet. You're not a god. And the minute you have varieties, and the bigger the ummah, the more the varieties will be. Even some people will do the varieties wrong. So your job is just to address it, and your job is to open the area and let the general public they follow their imam. They ask and somebody guide them. They follow it. خلاص. But you have the luxury of academia and discussing and all of that. That's fine, but it stays in the level of academia, يعني, the level of fiqh discussions and all of that. Now, what would be the basics? Al-aqidah? Yes, I agree. But how, يعني, while you are teaching them aqidah, are you going to abandon the akhlaq? Do you want to say we're going to learn aqidah only? What is that? يعني, al-aqidah itself, few pages, يعني. Like what are you exactly referring to teaching the basics on aqidah? I feel as a professor and as an academic person, as a researcher, that's not what you want. You are saying something, but in your head there is something else. You know what I hear when you say that? You are saying we have to enforce a certain way of aqidah. You are not saying teach people aqidah. You are saying teach people aqidah, but that's not what is in your head. Because people have been teaching aqidah. Okay, you teach, you bring 100 people and teach them aqidah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Go guys, yalla. What happened now? What is the way to gauge what you taught is implemented? Yani, how? Well, we teaching aqidah. All of this shuyukh teaching aqidah forever. What did that take the ummah? Yani? And I'm not putting down anyone. Wallahi, I'm not. Just being very practical, pragmatic, يعني. So where what you are suggesting already happened, it took place already in different ways over 1400 years, right? The more details you go, the more ilm al-kalam you open, the more deviation going to happen. Don't think that you are actually patching a hole. You are making the hole much, much bigger. You know, the minute you start discussing a sifat, khalas, division will become more. When you leave it without, يعني when it was there without, يعني who discussed قل الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. Until people became Muslims, they have philosophies. Now they started asking questions and the ulama felt the need, then they started inventing new terminology and all of that. And then people started using their brain and they started dividing. المعتزلة اعتزلوا والخوارج خرجوا والشيعة تشيعوا ويعني فإيفن the Sunnah among themselves started differing. هذا أشعري وهذا متريدي وهذا this وهذا that. Why all this come from? Then you digged more. So you doing that, then you come and say we need to have it black and white. How? We were black and white one time. But the more you dig and the more you discuss and the more you open these kind of discussions, the more deviation is going to happen. Right? So now, I don't think there is a time when they come and say, will teach people العقيدة ولا طب اوكي teach the people basics. when I'm teaching the people basics forever يعني all the time we teach العقيدة وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون والله واحد والله قدير all of that. but what is the way to gauge what I'm teaching is working? that's authority right away. سلطة يعني that's أحكام سلطانية يعني authority right away. الهلال we saw it or not saw it. ده سلطان كمان زيد we saw it. خلاص يلا رمضان tomorrow. أحكام سلطانية. المون sighted is sighted. end of the deal. ها خلاص ذو الحجة بدأ ذو الحجة بدأ يعني now we know when we're gonna stand in عرفة. لازم يكون في سلطان. otherwise everybody will say whatever right. and the sultan cannot come and even say this is the way and every other way is wrong. he cannot even do that. مفيش خليفة عمل كده يعني except the Fatimi Khalifas and look where it took the people you know they make lots of problems you know when they forced people one way or the other. فعلا this discussion is very important but when you see the problem of the ummah is such and such the division and the way to solve it is such now we have a problem like who's talking based on what data you are talking based on what historical background you are talking and what is your plan what is your strategy where are the goals how are you going to apply that who's going to help you applying that it's just a talk then right so you have to give me all these points then we'll see even if we have all of that and you give me the study we're going to teach them aqidah over the next 20 years 50 years 100 years we do this in every masjid on the planet da 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 da, da, da all of this give me a good plan of your suggestion and give me said it worked in the history it worked in Andalusia it worked like this and here are my proofs yani do a good search yani research but when you are saying this categorical stuff very emotional stuff I love it but where is it going to take us nowhere it's very emotional like a khatib yani in khutbah it's very emotional but when you sit in a lecture it's not emotional am I clear in this I think we need to have a lecture about that do I make sense Osama Tayyib all brothers
yes
Allah be with you but the subject is like you have to always think and that's part of my training to my students and all that always accuse yourself like think how can I make this work okay I cannot make it work then who does then who
my question was one of the brothers in the group and he was saying we need to create a program a new AI that's going to you know, take all of the situations of the history and the hadith and the interpretations and give a conclusive answer that'll be acceptable by a council and by a group of... So that was one suggestion. I was like, no, if we have enough decency of understanding and we take care of the new Muslim community, we take care of the elderly, we take care of the youth, we take care of the immigrant community that comes to America at least if we do these kind of things and teach them the proper way of how we're doing it we can't have a generalized like this is the way that we're going to do it in America so we have to do it everywhere else no it has to be in every place its own form of how they reach a conclusion of how they're going to succeed and if like Africa is going to have different issues it's not going to be the Western issues Asia is
going to
have different issues.
صحيح. That's what I'm saying. Like even in America, even in America, who has the power to decide what is good for all the Muslims in America?
For me, it was just saying a baseline to start.
But that's for you. But that's for you. Yeah. That's what I'm trying to say. That's for you. But what you think now? How many people are convinced with what you think? Exactly. Well, at the end of the day, it is only you, Osama. That's what I'm trying to say. And it's okay that you express your opinion, right? But I can come and say, no, the baseline is not what we need now. I'm not saying that I am, but I'm just, you know, here, just being different. Yeah. Baseline, we all know the baseline. Let's discuss, like you said now, the advocacy. Like, you know, what we care about is, you know, like people's right, Muslims' right, refugees, all of that. Some people, refugees, they said this is how it is. And people in care and all of that, they said, you know, this is the Muslim rights. And whenever an incident happens, you, we told you it's supposed to be like this, you know, we told you, but you guys are busy with wudu and all of this kind of things, right? And then you come to someone and said, no, I'm going to teach the people the Quran and all that. Then you go to the Tablighi Jama'at and they say, this is the religion and all of that. Then where is the baseline? The baseline of what? Like, what is the baseline? Yani everybody have their baseline. I already have my baseline. I'm Tablighi Jama'at. I already have my baseline. You're not going to change my baseline. You're not going to give me a new baseline. I already have a baseline and I'm functioning, man. I am the biggest jama'ah in the world and we're traveling everywhere and people are coming to the masjid and all of that. What are you going to tell him? Seriously. And somebody like working in, you know, defending the cases of discrimination and all of that. You come and tell him baseline, come and learn aqidah. I said, aqidah what, man? What are you talking about? Look at those criminal cases and discrimination and bias around and all of that. You go to the refugees, said, how many, you know how many people we're feeding every day, brother? You're talking to me about baseline? Fahimt ya Usama kalam? That the people, everyone thinking that they are serving Islam the best, and I don't disagree. By the way, they serving Islam the best way they could. Yes, so that's good. But you cannot say Islam is defined through you. It's not enough to tell me Islam is being involved in the political things, and that's my baseline. You know, and the other one, but what baseline? Who decided the baseline? Like you said, you know, put everything to the AI. It's the shame, isn't it the shame, yani, that, you know, we program something to tell us how to practice our deen. Yani, we're going to come up with a new, okay, the AI came with a suggestion. But sana, yani, for the sake of discussion with you, yani, you're going to laugh now. Yani. Type. The AI is our mufti now. Alas, it comes with one solution fits all. Tamam? What if someone decide not to follow the AI? That final solution, yani. Kida Mamdouh and his students said, you know what, guys? Following AI is bid'ah. Who am I now?
Ah, who
am I now? Who am I? How are you going to classify me? You're going to go ask the AI how classify Mamdouh? And you're going to take his hukm, yani? Oh, he's a kafir? He's a mubtada' if he does not follow me, Mr. AI? يعني this is the conclusion and whoever does not follow it is not a Muslim. ينفع يعني
شيخ.
Yes,
you can also have people who come up with competing AIs with each other.
Here you go, thank you man, I love it. So people will feed the Hanafi only to the AI. and even the idea itself, how are you going to entertain it? Like gather what? Like, who's going to gather everything? Yani, how? Someone is going to hide something.
Well, exactly. Well, this is what the no-fly programmers are. The programmers that program for the no-fly list, they're programming based on something that they have in their minds, and it doesn't give the proper answer at the end.
Thank you. Let's assume, yani, hypothetically speaking, that we as human beings, Muslims, we all succeeded to feed the AI everything. Here, are you ready for the big one? And then after they feed the AI, they found a treasure trove of books that nobody like gave to the AI. So now you have to train the AI. So now a baby is getting trained, you are listening to. It's not a human being, yani. The whole issue is flawed, yani. I'm sorry, but people have dreamy stuff. You know why? Because we have full stomach. That's my opinion, yani. We have full stomach. We have luxury. So now we start discussing about hypothetical stuff. But as you said, some people in Africa have different priorities, completely different priorities. Yani, you go to someone who did not eat for a week. You come tell him to come, I'll teach you aqidah. Come on, yani. You do not teach these people aqidah, you know. You're going to feed them first. You're going to give them nutrition first. You're going to take care of their health first. You're going to tell them God is beautiful, Allah loves you, all of that. You're not going to force everything on them because they're sick, man. They are hungry people. you know, and then you're going to teach them Salah and all of that. Then you teach Aqidah. يعني you can teach Aqidah. You said La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. I'll explain that later to you. But let's get to the prayer and all of that, because Zuhr is coming, Asr is coming, Maghrib, Isha, Fajr is coming, right? It's not going to wait for you when you have a lesson of Aqidah. يعني. Wallahu a'lam. جزاكم الله خيرا. May Allah reward you all. It's a beautiful discussion. We continue next time, inshallah.